I could just get everyone's attention, we'll do a quick introduction. I just want to let you know, my name is J.D. Comas. I'm the Director of Programs and Education for the First Division Museum. We're very excited to have you all out here today. Thank you for coming out. Just a quick bit about the park. If you've not been here, this is the historic estate of Colonel Robert R. McCormick, who served with the First Division in World War I. And after his passing, he wanted the park left for the people of Illinois, and he wanted the history of the division preserved and told to the public. And so that's why the First Division Museum is here. So we'll get right into the program. Let me introduce, please, Doug Bradley and Craig Werner, both professors at Madison University, who have written a book, We Gotta Get Out of Here. And so they're going to talk about music and Vietnam. Thank you very much.
Okay. Whoa. Okay, they'll let me know what's wrong with that. Can you guys hear me?
Yeah.
Wonderful. Thank you all for coming. It's great to be here. It's wonderful to see so many people. Welcome home to my fellow veterans. It's going to be a great night. Lots of music, which is, of course, why you came, right? I have to do a special shout out to our friend Bill Brewster, who used to be with the Wisconsin Veterans Museum. I know Bill then. He was very instrumental early on when we were starting this book to connect us with some of the veteran groups and folks that we wanted to talk to. So, Bill, thank you very much. He's doing a great job here, and we still miss him. We were able to get through the Cheddar Curtain tonight. People told me that would be difficult coming from Wisconsin, but we made it. And we're here. We're going to get rid of the cheese, and we're going to give you a lot of the good music.
Yeah. When we started writing this book, one of the first things that we did was think that we were going to organize it around a Vietnam Vets Top 20. Choose 20 songs and tell the story of Vietnam through those songs, Vietnamese music through those songs. We started interviewing Vets, and very quickly it became obvious that it was going to be a top 200 or a top 2,000 or something like that. And I think there may be 2,000
in the book.
Songs mentioned in the book. And we worked on it over 10 years, and the only reason we quit is because too many of the men and women who served in Vietnam were dying. And we felt like it was we needed to get the story told now. We've done something like 70 of these events since the book came out in late October. And at almost every event, I think, there we've heard stories that should be in the book. And one of the cores of what we hope we will do tonight is open a space where those of you who served, family members, can share some of your stories, can share your stories with us and with the other people here. We teach a class on Vietnam at UW, and the first thing we tell our students is that there's no such thing as the Vietnam vet experience, breaking down that stereotype. We tell them that the first thing you need to do is know what we call the three W's. When someone was in Vietnam makes a big difference if you were there between 60 and 64, makes a big difference if it was during the Johnson years, makes a big difference if you were there when Doug was in the wind down of the war. Where you were makes a huge difference. Obviously, if you're in I Corps or the Mekong Delta or in the Iron Triangle, very, very different experiences. And in some ways, perhaps most importantly, what you did, what your MOS was. In the book, we talked to brass, we talked to grunts, we talked to rimps, we talked to dog handlers, we talked to field bakers, we talked to a lot of women who were in Vietnam, and that one of the things that emerges from that is that in some ways, Vietnam is an intensely individual story. We got stories from people. When we started our interviews, early on, we discovered that the best way to start an interview was simply to say, did you have a song, man? Something that connected with that. And a lot of vets who really wouldn't talk about Vietnam, if you go and say, hey, man, how was Vietnam, right? Stonewall, but if you say, was there a song there? Frequently, and we'll tell some of those stories tonight, it was like turning on a faucet, that the stories just poured out. And the hardest thing about the book was that when you ask that kind of question, you're in somebody's life for 2 hours, right? You're in there for a long time, and only the tip of that iceberg shows up in the book, the part that's about music. But we heard stories that inform, I think, everything that was in there. So part of the stories that we heard were really individual. And that's part of the reason there are 2,000 songs, songs that connected with particular memories of people. But a part of the story was also shared. And one of the stories that points to that most clearly is the story we start the book with. It's one of Doug's stories, and he'll tell that to you now.
So getting back to the three W's that Craig mentioned, my three W's are 1970 and 1971, Long Binh, South Vietnam, and 71Q20, my MOS, which made me an Army journalist. So realize how radically different this is from somebody who was there, and I just talked to a gentleman down here who was there in 67 and 68 at the height of the Tet Offensive and when, you know what was hitting the fan in Vietnam in more ways than one, and probably out in the field, in do or die circumstances. So I'm there in 70 and 71, and the reason for that is I thought I'd be there a little earlier. We all know what a lot of people, I'm sure this audience, it'll resonate with a lot of audiences we talk to, especially younger people, they don't know what a draft was like. And that, you know, when you were 18, they still sign up for selective service. I mean, they do that. But then you became out, you got a draft classification. I was in college, so they gave my I was a 2S, which meant I had a student deferment, which meant other guys were going to Vietnam while I wasn't, okay? But if everybody remembers Johnson's, announcement in 1968 when he went on television, he said he wasn't going to run for president. What people forget about that talk that night was he canceled draft deferments for everybody but doctors and dentists. So usually if you were in school and you went to graduate school, I was going to law school that fall. I was going to graduate in May of 69, and I was going to get a law degree, I thought. But I was going to lose my student deferment. I wasn't going to be 2S. So I graduated in May of 69. You know, by June, I was 1A. So 2S was student deferment. 1A means come and get me, okay? And they did. But what was interesting was we had an election in that interim, of course, and Richard Nixon became president, and he had what he called a secret plan to win the war. It turned out to be a program he called Vietnamization, where he was turning the ground war over to the South Vietnamese army, the ARVN, our ally, and he was intensifying the air war in North Vietnam, trying to bring the North Vietnamese to the negotiating table. And so, lo and behold, I passed my physical. I dropped out of law school, of course. I passed my physical in October, but they canceled November and December draft calls, and I make it to the first lottery. So I'm thinking like, hey, oh, man, this is good news. You know, I mean, I'm lucky. I'm a lucky guy. Well, not so lucky, because, you know, they put 366 birthdays in that. I don't know if you remember that. It was televised by all the networks. You know, we only had three then. But, you know, they were all there. I mean, it's like a big event. You know, these big old guys, you know, just sort of pulling, you know, these balls. It's like, you know, the lotto. And I got pulled 85. The day after my birthday was 366. I'm 85. I know I'm going. So by March, I'm in basic training. And by November, I'm in Vietnam. It's a little different than law school. But luckily for me, I think that interim had a lot to do with my fate, because by then we were starting to bring guys home from the peak of about 550,000. We're starting to bring guys home, and they started to align what I had done in college with what I could do in the military. So they made me an Army journalist, because I was an English major in college. I wrote for the school newspaper, etc. So, you know, hey, okay, in the lexicon of all things, you know, I'm in Vietnam, not so good, but I'm in the rear, it's 70 and 71, I've got a pen and not a rifle. So, hey, that's not bad, right? A lot of you guys in the audience can attest to this. The other thing the Army wanted to do, because things were starting to unravel, I mean, you know, like, when I was there in Vietnam, everybody's mantra was, I don't want to be the last GI killed in Vietnam. If we're going home, if we're turning this war over to them and it's their war, don't do anything stupid that's going to put me in harm's way and I'm not going to get back. So, I mean, that was sort of the pervading idea. And things, you know, when somebody gave you an order you didn't want to follow, or you knew because they hadn't been there as long as you had that was going to be trouble, you didn't do it. And sometimes if they said, I'm going to court-martial you, Well, you know, we'll go there a little bit later in terms of what the ramifications of that could be. So, you know, so here I am, so they had to keep us engaged. How do they keep us connected? By then, we're sending more ground troops home. Hey, you know, the Big Red One's gone by the time I get there. They left in 1970. So, you know, we've got less guys in the field, more guys in the rear. So what do? They give us creature comforts. They wanted us to feel like we were in America. And what was one of the things they gave us? Music. All the time. Remember, I'm in the rear, okay? AFVN, Armed Forces Vietnam Network, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, transmitters all around the country. And hey, by the time I'm there, some of these guys are sounding like, you know, the early FM DJs. They're playing some kind of good stuff at midnight, you know, 2 a.m. You know, they're getting a little like Adrian Cronauer. And, you know, real tape decks. I still have all my sound equipment from Vietnam. You know, my speakers, my Sansui amp, you know, my TAC tape deck. I mean, this stuff works forever. So we could buy stuff, we could listen to stuff. There were minstrels in the hoots that played songs. We had bands at the M Club, really good cover bands. I mean, they got a little bad when they tried to do Yellow Liver. But you know, we had Vietnam bands, we had Korean bands, we had, you know, Filipino bands, and then live acts came over. James Brown came to Vietnam. Johnny Cash was in Vietnam. You know, so Nancy Sinatra, Bill's favorite, was in Vietnam. So we had music. So here we are. I'll set the scene for you. So AFVN decides on Labor Day of 1971, when I was still there, they're going to have a top 500 countdown over Labor Day weekend. And we're thinking, like, Labor Day? That's every day. I mean, what are you talking to us? You know, we're working all the time. We're not, you know, we're in Vietnam. But they have this countdown, and they have the disc jockeys. And so it's around midnight, you know, getting close to midnight, when they're going to kick this off for the weekend on AFVN. And if you're not on guard duty or not back at the office, we're sort of hanging out at the hooch. And we decide, hey, this could be interesting. So one guy comes up, you know, a guy from the, you know, South, he absolutely loves the King, slams down like a $5 bill on this makeshift bar we have. And he says, you know what? The first song they play is going to be by the King. You know, I mean, Elvis started this whole thing. He started rock and roll. It's our music. First song's by Elvis. Another guy comes up. He says, you got to be kidding. He says, we got a new King now. His name's Bob Dylan. He knows what's going on. He's talked about it. He's sung about it. First song's by Dylan. Somebody else comes up and says, wait a minute. You know, this is going to be about the new sound here in Vietnam. It's Jimi Hendrix. So all of a sudden, some guy comes up. And now, you know, we can't spend our money anyway in Vietnam. What are we doing with greenbacks anyway? And he puts a ration card down on the bar. Well, now we're talking about something that matters. This is your cigarettes, your beer, and your hard liquor for a month. So this is so next thing you know, I mean, ration cards are coming down on the bar. Now realize this is the benefits of living in the rear, okay? So we got these ration cards piling up, and guys are screaming CCR, you know, Motown, you know, the Beach Boys, you know, and somebody starts to take odds on this sort of makeshift bulletin board we have. And, you know, the stoners were holding tight with the Doors, you know, and Cream, you know. The country guys were holding tight with Johnny Cash and a few others. We had one soul brother. He said Motown. We had to play something by Motown. But, you know, I mean, we're going back and forth, and we're all just laying down what it's going to be. What is the first song going to be? This is the first song that they played that night on AFVN. And we all looked at each other and said, we forgot where we are. How did we miss this? This is our anthem. The city where the sun refused to shine. Sing along.
People tell me it ain't no use in trying. My little girl, you're so young and free. And one thing I know is true. You're gonna die before your time is due. See my daddy in bed dying. If it's the last thing we'd ever do, we gotta get out of this place. Girl, there's a better life for me and you.
How did we miss that? You know, arguing about the music we grew up with and thinking about maybe for 15 minutes we were back home, we forgot where we were. And that was our song, that was the anthem. And I tell you, if you were a cover band and you couldn't play that song, you got chased off the stage. Eric Burden, 75 years old today. Woo, I think that's dating a lot of us. It's his, interesting that we're here and it's his birthday. And we would change that last line in the song that there's a better place in the USA.
One of the things that we learned earliest when we started doing the interviews was that whereas there was a lot of music in Vietnam, as Doug talked about, there was one place where there wasn't music, and that was in the field, right, in combat units, where silence was worth your life, literally, to have that. And we heard some good stories from vets who spent their time in the field, and they had music connected with it, but in some different ways. We had one guy, a rifleman from Kentucky, who told the story of when he got drafted, and they told him where he's from. They made him a rifleman because they assumed everybody from Kentucky could shoot. And he said, "I had never even shot a damn squirrel in my life." But he talked about being out on at a post one night when he got his girlfriend's favorite song, which was Leslie Gore's "Judy Turned to Cry," stuck in his head, and he said that was dangerous. Right, that it interfered with what he was doing. And we had another story told by a guy, one of our friends in Madison, Tom Dietz, who was a member of the Big Red One out there, about being out, and he spent most of his time in combat in Vietnam, being out there. And he said that one night he was out there when there was one of those quiet moments, which were not unusual, right? That was the question, and he had this song connected with that. This is the first time in the 70s or so things we've done that we played this one. Some of you will recognize it. And the 60s powerhouse Herman's Hermits.
There's a kind of hush all over the world. Tonight, all over the world, you can hear the sounds of lovers in love. You know what? Sight. There's nobody else, and I'm feeling good, just holding you tight.
So that's not the center of the Vietnam story, but it's a part of the Vietnam story. And that's one of the things I think came out as we talked to people, that all kinds of different songs connected with all kinds of different experiences. The next song we're going to play was the song that in 1966, which was an amazing year for music, the Beatles are at their peak. The Stones are at their peak. Motown is putting out unbelievable music week by week by week. At one point, Motown had 6 of the top 10 songs in the United States. That's why they had different labels, so that DJs didn't know they were playing a whole bunch of Motown songs. They played Tamla and Soul and whatnot. They thought it wasn't all Motown, but it was all Motown coming out of the same place. But for that year, the song that we're going to play now was the number one song in the United States.
Entire year.
Y'all heard it, huh?
Fighting soldiers from the sky. Fearless men who jump and die. Men who mean just what they say. The brave men of the Green Beret.
Silver wings upon their chest. These are men, America's best. 100 men will test today, but only 3 win the Green Beret. Trained to live off nature's land.
I've got to jump to the end of the song.
Back at home, a young wife waits. Her Green Beret has met his fate. He has died for those oppressed, leaving her this last request. Put silver wings on my son's chest. Make him one of America's best. He'll be a man they'll test one day. Have him win the Green Beret.
Barry Sadler. Yeah. Bow to the Green Berets. And this speaks volumes to why this music is so central and important, because if you were, I mean, it didn't matter where you were in America. You heard the song. Radio was our internet, and we all listened to the same soundtrack. If you didn't want to listen to the Green Berets, it would be over, and they would play My Girl, or they would play, you know, something, These Boots Are Made for Walking, you know, because it was just, we didn't have the internet. Yeah, we didn't email, but we all had radio, and radio was our shared soundtrack, and the music connected us all. So whether you participated or protested, whether you stayed or you served, you listened to the same music. And that had resonance in Vietnam. One of the early stories we have, another guy that Bill knows named Jim Kurtz, who was a captain in Vietnam, Big Red One at Zion. Jim was in ROTC at Madison and ended up getting through law school. So he's a law degree. He's a lawyer. But he's got his service to perform because of his ROTC contract. So he ends up in Vietnam. And that song, when it came out in 66, 50 years ago, spoke to Jim Kurtz, you know. And for Jim Kurtz, you know, this was, you know, for Jim Kurtz, and I know, pardon me, I know I'm in Illinois, but for Jim Kurtz, this song was like On Wisconsin. He thought, he'd listen, you know, we'd march through the country, we'd get to the end zone, we'd score a touchdown, we'd win for freedom and democracy, and we'd go home. Well, after Jim Kurtz is in Vietnam for a few months, he realizes this is not what's going on. He's losing too many men. He's getting orders that he can't understand. He doesn't think we're fighting the war in the way we should be fighting it. And he is one pretty disillusioned guy. So when I interview Jim Kurtz 40, 45 years after he's been in Vietnam and ask him what his song is, and he says it's this, it's because he wants to say, that's nonsense. You know, that wasn't right. That isn't what happened. I can't listen to that song anymore, which is one of the interesting things we get, because not everybody will, people still won't talk, even if it's a song. But sometimes when people do, it's about a song that they don't want to hear anymore, that they don't want to talk about anymore. The other funny thing, interesting thing about the Ballad of the Green Berets, it is the most parodied song in the history of recordings, because you, as a branch of the military, you can't get too puffed up and think the other branches of the military are lesser than you are. So we talked to Marines. We talked to Army aviators. We talked to Navymen. We talked to the Brownwater Navy. Everybody had a parody of this song. And I'll just read you one of them, which is great. And this was one, you know, from a fellow we had, Marty Hoyer, who was with the Army Aviation. Frightened soldiers from the sky screaming, hell, I don't want to die. You can have my job and pay. I'm a chicken any old way.
There it is. Obviously, when you deal with Vietnam, politics is a big piece of the story. And one of the things that we did our best to do as we wrote the book was to get ourselves out of the way and to let the stories of the men and women who had served carry the book, which means that there's a lot of politics in the book because the men and women who served have politics, right? We did our best to move ourselves back. from that. But one of the songs that really highlights some interesting pieces of the political picture and also highlights one of the major themes of the book, which is that songs tended to mean something very different on the home front than they meant in Vietnam, came to a head around this one, which again is a song I'm pretty sure that all of you know.
Give me an F!
There's another version of the cheer.
Up a gun, we're gonna have a whole lot of fun. And it's one, like a two, like a three, what are we fighting for? Don't ask me, I don't give a damn. Next up is Vietnam. And it's five, six, seven, open up the pearly gates. Ain't no time to wonder why we're all gonna die. Well, come on, General, let's move fast. Your big chance has come at last. Gotta go out, get those reds. The only good commie is one that's dead. And you know that peace can only be won when the glory of all the kingdom come. And it's one, two, three, what are we fighting for? Don't ask me, I don't give a damn. Next stop is Vietnam. And it's five, six, seven, open up the pearly gates.
And in a couple of our verses, that's be the first one on your block to have your boy come home in a box. Well, when we met Country Joe McDonald, Country Joe and the Fish, who was really one of the most important people for connecting us with Vets Networks as we wrote the book, when we met him at the BART station in Berkeley, the very first thing he said to us is, I consider myself a veteran first and a hippie second. And for me, that was a little bit of a stunner because I'd seen Country Joe and the Fish when I was a hippie in Colorado back in the late 60s, early 70s. I was 1952, which meant I went through a year expecting to be drafted and wasn't. I was the only year that could happen. And my band played for a lot of GI audiences down at Fort Carson, so I was at peace. That's part of what led me here. But I'd seen Country Joe a number of times, and he usually wore his military jacket with McDonald on it. I don't know what the hell I thought that meant. But it didn't register to me at the time. Country Joe, obviously, that song was heard as irreverent, anti-patriotic by a lot of people. Country Joe McDonald still gets hate mail to this day for I Feel Like I'm Fixing to Die. But we heard very different responses to that when we interviewed people for the book.
Yeah, and what Joe told us and what other people reaffirmed was that, you know, if you're in the worst situation of your life, if things are so, so bad that you just want to sort of curl up and die, what do? You laugh. I mean, you use gallows humor. Joe intended this song as gallows humor. He thought, well, soldiers will get this because, you know, it's like, how irreverent can you be? It's like, what are they going to do, send us to Vietnam and we're going to get killed, you know? And the amazing thing was we had this reaffirmed by, you know, some of the most, you know, hardcore, you know, sort of go over then kick some butt, you know, soldiers that there were in Vietnam, a guy named Bo Gritz, among others, who made his soldiers sing this song, you know, because he got it. Hey, a lot of people in the rest of the world in America, including today, didn't get it, that it was gallows humor, that you needed to find some laughter. Otherwise, you were going to go crazy, you were going to cry. And one of the more poignant stories we got, and this is not going to sound unfamiliar to, I'm sure, a lot of you, is because people didn't talk about this. You know, my kids, I was early on in the progress of the book, maybe 2006 or 7, I was at a neighborhood potluck because my kids played soccer with some of the other kids, and so the parents had a potluck. And there'd been an article in the local paper about our working on the book, and the guy whose house we were at leans over to me after my wife says, did you see, you know, the article in the paper, he says, I'm a Vietnam vet and I want to tell you about a song. Well, other than me at that point and his wife, Nobody else knew he was a Vietnam vet. This guy had lived in this community for 30, 40 years. All these people knew him. Their kids knew him. Nobody knew he'd been in Vietnam. So I go back to his house two nights later, and like Craig says, you can't just go in and out of somebody's life. Gee, tell me something painful, and then I'll see you later. No. You know, this has been locked up for this guy, his name was Neil, for 40 years. So I go back to his house a couple nights later. He has his two daughters there, because they've never heard this. So he has his daughters are sitting there. He went up into his attic and brought down all this memorabilia. I don't know where he, I mean, Bruce would love this guy because he had great stuff. You know, he brought down like uniforms. He had aerial photographs of his base. He had all kinds of memorabilia. And he started to talk. And the song that made him talk was this song. And the story he told was when he was getting out of the Army in late 69, he was a combat engineer. Sometimes there was more combat than engineering. And they were getting processed out of Fort Lewis. And the way tours went in Vietnam, 13 months for Marines, 12 months for Army, unless you extended. So we were rotating guys at a fairly regular basis in and out of Vietnam. So here's a bunch of grizzled Vietnam vets sitting at Fort Lewis. You know, this is not, you know, they're not passing inspection. They got beards, they got boonie hats. You know, their fatigues are dirty. They've had it. They've had it, and they want to get the hell out, and they want to get the heck home. And at the same time, a whole bunch of FNGs, I'll let you fill in the F, new guys are walking past them to go over to Vietnam. You know, freshly scrubbed troops marching in order, doing what they're told, as opposed to these guys. So one of the guys in this group with Neil hits the cassette deck, and he starts to play this song. And the guys start going one, two, three, at the new guys. What are we fighting for? And Neil's telling me the story to he and his daughters. And then he stops. And he's like, he's choking up. He's about crying. And he said, I'm sorry. He said, I wish I could go back now and apologize to every one of those guys. Because I was not mad at them. I didn't mean to do that. But I was angry about my year in Vietnam. I was angry about the men I had lost. I was angry about the government and what the war was doing, and I took it out on them, and I'm sorry I did it.
When Doug and I started working on this, as I said, we were thinking we were going to do it around the top 20, and we got together on the terrace down at Madison, had a couple of pitchers of beer one day, compared our list of the 20 songs we thought would be a part of it, and we had 15 or 16 overlaps. It was pretty close to that. And some of that kind of reflected the soundtrack that we get in the movies about Vietnam, things like the documentaries, where there's some songs that show up repeatedly. And those songs are a part of the Vietnam soundtrack. I don't want to downplay them, but they're not the center of it. And we found that out very, very quickly. We had, you know, number one on that mythical top 20 list. We do have the top 20 in the book, even though we know it's a parlor game, as opposed to anything real on that. But number one is we got to get out of this place, no question about that. Number two is probably I Feel Like I'm Fixing to Die that came up. But the number three song, the third most frequently mentioned song, was one that neither one of us had on our original list. I'll play that now, and it reflects something really basic about the actual soundtrack of Vietnam.
All my bags are packed, I'm ready to go. I'm standing here outside your door. I hate to wake you up to say goodbye. But the dawn is breaking, it's early morn. Taxi's waiting, he's blowing his horn. Already I'm so lonesome, I could cry. So kiss me and smile for me. Tell me that you'll wait for me. Hold me like you'll never let me go.
Well, the thing that we'd obviously overlooked, although both of us knew it, is that the average soldiers in Vietnam were 19, 20, 21, whatever the age was. And like young men everywhere, what are they thinking about? They're thinking about loneliness. Songs like Bobby Vinton's Mr. Lonely shows up a lot. Any song about wanting to go home, Detroit City, Sloop John B. Any song about a girl, brown-eyed girl, my girl, Gloria, you name it. But this one, Peter, Paul, and Mary hit a special chord.
Yeah, I mean, I think John Denver's greatest song and a wonderful recording. And what's interesting is, you know, we had a tour of the, and if you haven't seen the museum, you got to come back and see it. It's fantastic. And there's this wonderful video about Omaha Beach and the invasion. And what does the guy talk about in the letter he's writing home? Girls and home. So this is universal to, you know, men and women away from home in difficult situations. What gives them comfort? Remembering the person that they love and wanting to be back with the people that they love, back in their home. And that's what this song was all about. When we did an event at LZ Lambeau, it was a welcome home ceremony. They did the Green Bay Packers, the Oneida Tribe, the Veterans Museum, Wisconsin Public Television, the Historical Society. They held it at Lambeau Field. And when we gave a presentation, it was the wives that sang this song much more strongly than the guys because, and I never thought about it. I thought about me leaving. I might not be back again. You know, that's my song, right? Maybe I don't want to hear it because it's going to tear me up and I can't tear up. I'm a guy. But, you know, the women were, and it's like I never thought of it. They had to say goodbye too and think of what, and I never really thought about what their year was like. Having to every day worry about what was happening to us. And so that song for both those who left and those who stayed has really powerful, powerful connections and resonance.
Next song we're going to play is one that really highlights the difference between the way songs were understood on the home front and the way that they were understood in Vietnam. In our survey, there were certain songs that showed up a lot, and then there were certain artists that showed up a lot. Right. Aretha Franklin shows up a lot. Creedence Clearwater shows up a lot. And the guy we're going to play now, Jimi Hendrix, shows up a lot. It wasn't particularly one song by any of them. It was a whole bunch of different songs by them. But this song did show up a bunch. You will know it.
You'll know it.
You start. Well, Hendrix is partially about the songs, but just partially about the sound of what it sounded like. On the home front, where I was, Purple Haze was a song about LSD. They color-coded types of acid. If you were getting yellow, that was pretty mild. If you got orange, that was a little heavier. If you got purple, that was heavy. And it's not that it wasn't a drug song in Vietnam, but it was a whole lot of other things.
Yeah, and as Craig said, I mean, one of the interesting things, here's another guy because of that era and what was going on. Hendrix was in the military. He was a member of the Screaming Eagles. He was probably the worst soldier the Army ever had. They kicked him out. All he wanted to do was play his guitar, and so they kicked him out. But he understood, I mean, that the fact that he had to jump out of airplanes gives that excuse me while I kiss the sky a little different meaning, okay? But in Vietnam, as Craig said, sonically, you know, Hendrix sounded like Vietnam a lot. If you ever heard his song Machine Gun, his Star Spangled Banner at Woodstock with the sort of distress call in there. I mean, this guy, I think he understood some of that and got it. And vets got it, too. Soldiers got it. And one of the more interesting stories we got was that, you know, there was an M-18 smoke grenade, and they came in four colors, okay? One of them was purple. So when they wanted to get a landing zone and they wanted to have a chopper come down and get people the heck out of that place, they would pop an M-18 smoke grenade. So for a lot of guys we talked to, forget acid, even maybe forget the fact that Hendrix is a former member of the Army and is sonically Vietnam. That song is about a landing zone and about getting a helicopter there and getting the heck out.
And like we said, we got some stories that were just absolutely idiosyncratic, individual. And maybe the favorite story that I got for the whole book was one about Purple Haze. And for the most part, we actually talked to the guys that gave us the stories. This one we got secondhand, but it was just too good a story not to put in the book. So generally we verified. The book's about memory more than what actually happened, right, what people remember about it. But worst job in the world, as far as I'm concerned, all time, is job of tunnel rat. You know, when you found the tunnels, yeah, I see some shutters there, man. When you found a tunnel, somebody had to go down into it and find out what was in it. And frequently it was booby traps, scorpions, you name it, in there. Just a horrible, horrible gig. Well, one of the guys we talked to talked about a guy in his unit who was a tunnel rat. And what he would do before he went down into the tunnel, he would pop one of those smoke grenades and take a little Mighty Might battery-powered fan and blow the smoke in so he could see where it came out, right, in the neighborhood, right, this kind of scout the area. And he would blast on his cassette deck Purple Haze to announce he was coming. Even if it's not true, it should have been. And so it is in the book. And it will stay there. One of the things that we've done as we've traveled around with the book is we try to tie in our stories locally. We don't want to do the same thing every night, or else we'd bore ourselves and then we'd bore you. But we try to tailor it a little bit to where we are. So we're in Memphis, and we're actually in the studio where Otis Redding and Sam and Dave record, and so we do Sam and Dave and Otis Redding. You know, when we do that kind of thing. And being in the Chicago area is a rich place for music, obviously. And particularly for African-American music. And that's a big part of the Vietnam story, the ways in which race could serve both, music could both serve as a flashpoint for racial tension, particularly later in the war, particularly if you were not out in the field, much more in the rear than in the field. But it could serve. There were firefights over what the Southern lifers were playing on jukeboxes, for example. And there are various stories like that. We have a story about what the guy told us was the first fragging in Vietnam, which had to do with tension over race and music. But music could also cross racial lines. It could also make connections between people who would not have otherwise connected with one another. And we have a lot of those stories in the book, too. And one of the songs that connects with that, and we actually got this story from a Chicano vet from East L.A., who was talking about the racial tension in his unit and the fact that the Chicano vets didn't quite fit into the black-white tension. And musically, they didn't fit into it. That they came out of a world in which soul music and rock music were equally present. They talked about how listening to African-American music in some ways politicized them, but in some ways led them to understand how destructive some of the tensions going on were. And I'm going to play a song now from one of the Chicano vets who talked about this song as being crucial to his thinking about race in Vietnam, by one of Chicago's great, great musicians, somebody who I wrote a book about and interviewed, Curtis Mayfield. And this song is Curtis both acknowledging the tension and saying that's not the way it ought to be, particularly in the military. And Curtis wrote a great album called Back in the World about a Vietnam vet returning to Chicago. Anyway.
Some people think we don't have the right to say it's my country. Before they give in,
they'd rather fuss and fight
than say it's my country. I paid 300 years or more of slave driving sweat and welts on my back. This is my country.
This is my country. And if anybody's got the right to say that, that's somebody who's done their tour in Vietnam. And that was a song that spoke to a lot of vets of many races, but it speaks to the fact that, yeah, you're dealing with people who think it's not your country, but it damn well is. And that was a big piece of the story we got.
Yeah, and the thing was, you know, I mean, everybody talks about, and we know the significance of the Tet Offensive. And even though basically it was a suicidal mission on behalf of the North Vietnamese Army, the impact it had, including on Walter Cronkite, who saw this on television, and Uncle Walter, you know, was like our uncle. And he said, you know, what the hell is going on? I thought we were winning this war. It changed perception. But, you know, for practically all the African-American vets we interviewed for this book, they talk about the assassination of Dr. Martin Luther King as being the critical moment when they realized that, you know, if you can't protect my leader at home, then what in the hell am I doing over here shooting at this guy that I don't know what my gripe with him is? And boy, did things change after Dr. King's assassination. So, you know, different sort of backgrounds and cultures, I mean, we all shared that, and yet the impact of that, especially on the African-American vets we interviewed, was profound, and it made a big, big difference. And trust me, when I was there in 70 and 71, things were not pretty. I mean, black guys had this dap thing. They would take 10 minutes to say hello to each other with the hand stuff. And, you know, it was like that was excluding them from us. I mean, there was a communication. It was like where I'd been, what I've done, who I'm with, who to stay away from. I had no idea. And, you know, there were units that were almost totally black by the time I was there because things, I mean, Colin Powell, when he went back for his second tour, he said he wouldn't sleep in the same tent two nights in a row. I mean, things were tough, and it was not a pretty time. We got through it. Not everybody did, and we're not post-racial yet, but I think there were some things that happened during that war that connected some of us. Music was a way to do that, that helped to bring us home together.
The last part of our book is about what music meant to vets when they came back to the world. The first three quarters of it, 80% of it is about music in Vietnam, but a big piece of it is about the ongoing importance of music. And that's largely a story of survival first, and then a story of healing. And all too often that didn't happen. At the LZ Lambeau event, one of the most stunning moments was they had on the field, the playing field, they had empty chairs for all of the Wisconsin vets who had died in Vietnam. And Jim Northrup, an Anishinaabe Native American veteran, who gave brilliant, brilliant talk there, said, look, for every chair out there on that field, there should be one for one of us who came home but didn't live. The suicides, the one car accidents, the substance abuse, you all know the stories on that. And it's a crucial piece of it. And part of what the stories we tell in the book are about are guys who acknowledge how strong the undertow was, how they just about didn't make it. And I'm going to play a song here that one of them talked about by another Chicago artist, Jerry Butler. And the vet, do you want to read a piece of his?
Yeah.
Yeah, go ahead and read that.
Yeah. This is by a guy, Ben Coleman's Burger. You can only get a name like that in Wisconsin. And he was from a, you know, a tiny, tiny town called Kekoskee, Wisconsin. I defy you to find it. And, I mean, this is what we found all too typical. His post-Vietnam years were marked by marriage, divorce, college, remarriage, divorce, graduate school, and lots of self-medication. So this is his quote. He says, "I was living at home, drinking too much, usually partying late into the night, often with a bunch of non-vets I'd brought home with me from the bar. One night I was standing outside singing Jerry Butler's Only a Strong Survive," another Chicago guy, we're going to play this, "at the top of my lungs, and it woke my parents. I can remember my dad coming over to me, looking me straight in the eye, almost boring a hole into my forehead. 'What the hell are you doing?' he asked me. I couldn't answer. That moment turned my life around."
I remember my first love affair. Somehow or another, the whole darn thing went wrong. But my mama had some great advice, so I thought I'd put it in the words of this song. I can still hear her saying, "Boy,
boy, boy,
oh, I see you sitting out there all alone, crying your eyes out, 'cause the woman that you love is gone. Oh, there's gonna be a whole lot of trouble in your life. Oh, so listen to me, get up off your knees, 'cause only the strong survive." That's what she said, "Only the strong survive. Only the strong survive. Yeah, you gotta be strong. You better hold on. Don't go."
Great song. And there's an example of a guy from small town Wisconsin turn into singer from the Chicago ghetto to find the song he needs at the moment he needs it. And that happens a lot. We talk to a lot of vets who made music themselves when they came home, who wrote folk songs, became jazz musicians. Kimo Williams, a black vet from Hawaii, who was every bit as confused by the DAP as Doug was. on it. He was a Led Zeppelin guy, and the brothers looked at him and said, "What the hell, man?" But Kimo wound up teaching music over at Columbia College in Chicago for a bunch of his life. Great guy. And he wrote symphonies performed by the St. Petersburg Orchestra, a symphony for the Sons of Nam. And that's a piece of the story. But another piece of it is the vets who found the music that they needed to speak to them at that moment when they were on the verge of checking out in whatever way. We talked to a couple of guys about the Beatles' White Album that spoke to them, songs like "Happiness is a Warm Gun" and things like that. But more than any other single record, this one that we're going to play now came up repeatedly as a crucial, crucial song for vets coming home, song and an album.
Hey, what's up,
Marvin Gaye?
Brother, what's up? This is a big party, man.
Yeah,
I can dig it.
Stop
it.
Right on.
Mother, mother, there's too many of you crying. Brother, 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 there's far too many of you dying. You know we've got to find a way to bring some loving here today. Yeah. Father, father, we don't need to escalate. You see, war is not the answer, for only love can conquer hate.
You know we've got to find a way
to bring some loving here today. Oh, picket lines and picket signs, don't punish me with brutality. Talk to me,
so you can see.
As Craig said, what's going on, Marvin Gaye, it's the title of a song and an album, one of the greatest things I think ever recorded. Marvin Gaye, you know, was probably as big as Motown ever got. He could not have a hit record. Whether he did it on his own or he sang with Kim Weston or Tammy Terrell, everything was a hit. And he was a big, big, big star. Well, Marvin's brother Frankie wasn't so lucky. Frankie Gaye was in Vietnam. And it wasn't pretty. He was there in 67 and 68, difficult time, saw some ugly things. And the way that we stayed connected with our families in that day was we didn't have email, we didn't have the internet. We wrote letters. And letters home, receiving letters was what was like manna from heaven. Writing letters home was therapy. And so what Frankie Gaye did was he was writing letters home to his parents, not thinking his big, important, you know, rock star brother Marvin was reading him. And he was talking about what he was seeing and what was paining him, what was going on with race relations and how the war was going bad. He was opening his heart to his family. Marvin Gaye was reading those letters. So when Frankie Gaye gets back from Vietnam, here's his brother, Marvin, waiting for him. And Marvin did what a lot of people didn't do for any Vietnam vets when they got back home, and that was to say, listen, I'm here. I'm not going to question you. I'm not going to push you. I'm not going to probe. I'm not going to judge. I'm going to listen. If you want to talk, I'm going to listen. Well, Frankie wanted to talk. They stayed up for about 2 days talking about Vietnam. When they got done, Marvin Gaye said, you know, I'm not a politician. I'm not going to run for office or change anything. I'm not a painter. I'm not going to paint a painting. But I'm a musician. I'm a singer. I'm going to write a song. Well, what he wrote was an album full of songs. And if you listen to the original What's Going On album, as it was recorded, the songs never end, because the first song, What's Going On, goes into the next song, just transitions right into What's Happening, Brother. And that goes into Fly the Friendly Skies, and that goes into Save the Children, and that goes into Holy Holy. Every song just sort of, you know, segues into the next song. Where you end on the album with Inner City Blues makes me want to holler, which is tough and strong, a statement about living in America and in that time as there is. And the last notes of Inner City Blues are the first notes of What's Going On. So this is a Vietnam veteran's odyssey of coming back and going through these stages of unemployment and disillusionment and self-medication and spirituality and trying to find himself and then starting all over again. So next time you listen to What's Going On, you know, think of Frankie Gaye coming back from Vietnam. That's his story, and it's a powerful story, and that's why I think it resonates with so many vets that we talk to.
Yeah, and Doug and I teach a class on Vietnam at UW, and our teaching assistants in it are two veterans of the more recent wars. One of them a black guy from Brooklyn, one of them a white guy from Minnesota. And I remember very strongly 6-7 years ago when we were playing What's Going On in the class and doing that cycle at the end and thinking, man, we've got that cycle. Let's not do this again. Let's not do to the vets of Iraq and Afghanistan what we have done to the vets of Vietnam. And I'm not opposed to saying thank you for your service, but that's not the answer. It has to go much, much, much deeper than that. It's not a cliche. It's listening. And What's Going On speaks to that. We're going to close with a piece of one of the solos in the book. One of the things we did in the book is a certain number of the vets we talked to said, well, I'd be happy to be in the book, but I'd rather write my own piece for you. Or sometimes we had interviews that were just so good that we edited them down. We said, we're not going to add anything to that. We edited it, sent it back to it, said, do you mind if we run this as what we call a solo? And one of the most powerful solos is from an African-American vet from Memphis, Art Flowers. And Art talks about how he came back from Vietnam as just your standard issue angry black guy. He was pissed off at everything. And he spent his first I don't know, 6-9 months back, I'm not sure how long, getting stoned, drinking, chasing women, just wasting his life. I mean, that's the way he talks about it. And then one day he was at a woman's apartment at the University of Tennessee, and it was the first time he heard the What's Going On album. And Art, who is now a professor of English at Syracuse University, and talks about himself as a cyber griot, a person who carries the memory of his community through the digital age. Really super interesting cat. But he talks about his response in his solo to hearing What's Going On. I'm going to read the end of it. "And far as I'm concerned, it's still that confused Viet Vet without a mission, laying on that college dorm floor in Knoxville, listening to Marvin Gaye hitting one magical note after the other, and weaving that spell on my soul. And sometime I look at the world and it still fills me with sorrow. But I know that those of us who care will make a difference in this world, that we will save the children, because this is a fight we cannot afford to lose. Once saw a sign on Fulton in Brooklyn say that I will never quit a fight nor die a loser. In some part, thanks to Marvin Gaye and What's Going On, I consider the generations, black folk and all humanity, to be in my special care. Are we going to find a way to bring some love in here today? Good looking out, my brother. You did your part, I'm going to do mine." We'll end it with that and invite your stories, questions. Thank you for being here. Microphone's on its way.
Yeah, I don't have a question for you two gentlemen, but for the entire audience in here. How many, I can only speak to the Army. I don't know anything about the other services. How many of you were RA in here? Raise your hand. Okay, how many were U.S.? Raise your hand. Okay. In the 80s, I couldn't believe this propaganda that was coming out. All the combat veterans in Vietnam were supposedly volunteers. I couldn't believe this stuff. Who the hell wants to be an infantryman, all right? I think the thing that impressed me most in the medical corps, at least, was there were so many guys. We had guys, I was in Korea, and we had a load of Vietnam veterans who were so-called profiles, okay? They weren't suitable for field duty anymore, so they assigned them light duties in Korea. They would not give out medical discharges. And when you're 18 or 19 years old, you are dumb. You don't know your rights. An honorable discharge, any pre-existing condition, any post-condition, I'm fine. I want out. And that's how they avoided giving medical discharges to these again. And I'll live with that until the day I die.
Songs, questions? Yes, sir.
What it's like to teach about Vietnam at UW, which isn't really known as the most conservative school in the country. And then a follow-up to that is, why do you think we were treated the way we were treated, and how wonderful it is now to see the veterans applauded at the airports and all that good stuff? We were told to change our clothes and look as much like civvies as we could. So
we bring you greetings from the People's Republic of Madison.
Yeah, the funny thing is, I mean, you know, that we teach this class to kids that were born in the mid-90s, the late 90s. So this could be the Peloponnesian Wars, as, you know. But they know the music. It's absolutely amazing how many of these young people, I mean, because it's accessible, but also because of their parents, and I dare say grandparents in some cases, that, you know, that music is so much in, you know, it's in the culture. It's there. And that's a great way to then connect them to the veteran stories. The other thing is we have auditors in our class, because if you're, one thing, we do nice things in Madison, too. We're not just all crazy. And one of the things we do is if you're over 62 and you're retired, you can take a class at the university for free with the consent of the professor. And it's amazing to watch the numbers of auditors that continue to grow. Half of them are Vietnam vets, okay? Half of them are former protesters. And what's interesting is to watch the dynamic, because they're finding more to, understand and acknowledge and forgive about one another than you would have thought. And I'm not giving us credit for that or the music. I think it's the way over time that some people feel pretty lousy about if they didn't do that directly, they did it indirectly. and, you know, they're ashamed. And I think the reason things shifted is because a number of Vietnam vets said, damn it, this is not going to happen to another generation of men and women who go to fight for the country. We tell them to go off and do that in our name, and that doesn't mean they have to come home and bear the whole moral burden of it. Now, having said that, you know, you guys, you and men and women, you've seen the numbers that I have, too, the numbers of suicides, the numbers of the domestic violence, the difficulties. It's the same in this generation. So the fact that we're applauding in airports and saying wonderful things doesn't mean that we stay with them day to day and say, what can I do? How can I help? Let me listen. Let me help. Because, you know, war is a totally different thing. And the civilian military divide is as great as it's ever been. I don't think it's healthy for the country. I don't know exactly how to fix it. But, you know, I like to think Vietnam vets made a difference in that. But we need to go further and do more because we're bringing people home that have had to do some really, really horrible things. And that's tough to get back.
Yeah. And on the protesters, I mean, this is one of those things that it's really important to separate the myths of Vietnam from what happened thereafter. And there's the myth that the anti-war movement was a bunch of hippies in Madison and Berkeley. The fact is that throughout the entire war, people with grade school educations were more opposed to the war than people with graduate degrees. And the particularly late in the war when the guys started coming home, the core of the anti-war movement was Vietnam vets. That was the part that scared. So it's a very, very complicated thing. And, you know, it was both the left and the right were complicit in that. The VFW posts were just as hostile to Vietnam vets frequently as were communes. You know, complicated. Nobody's got anything to be proud of in that story. We didn't want to deal with the reality. It was easier blaming it on you guys than it was coping with it.
Yeah, and I'd like to argue that that was like America's second Civil War. And we haven't recovered from the first Civil War. We haven't recovered from the second Civil War in ways because of the way we were divided and we like to blame and we were the last ones standing. So, you know, let's blame these guys and pretend everything's fine and move on. Anything else about music? Billy's coming up here. Oh, good. He's got the mic because there's lots of great music we didn't play tonight.
I have a question now.
Yes, sir.
In 1967, we were at a special forces camp, Play Me, and we were told that Barry Sandler was there a year earlier in 1966, and that's where he wrote the Ballad of the Green Beret. But other than people transmitting that to us, I never knew if that's
now,
true or not.
Barry wrote the Ballad of the Green Beret in a hospital near Fort Bragg. He had been in Vietnam in special forces and stepped on a punji stick and got an infection. Was medevaced out, went back to the States, and as he was recovering, they were dedicating the Green Beret, you know, sort of memorial at Fort Bragg and naming it after his brother. And so, naming it after JFK, and Robert Kennedy was speaking. So Sadler heard that and got this surge of sort of patriotism, and that's when he wrote the Ballad of the Green Berets. The interesting thing is it was also a book and a movie at the same time. We do that all the time now, but that was unique in that day. Robin Moore's book, The Green Berets, is a lot different than the song, The Green Berets, and both are different from John Wayne's movie, which I saw in Vietnam, and we threw beer cans at the outdoor theater because they had the sun setting in the east, you know, at the end of the movie. I mean, come on, this isn't a cowboy picture. I mean, the sun sets over here. Yes.
Yeah, at the beginning, I heard you gentlemen, you kind of made, I think it was a snarky remark about Adrian Cronauer. But,
did we do that?
Oh, we love
it. But anyhow, let me tell you, being out in the field, and we get back into camp in the mornings, and at 67, 68, Armed Forces Radio would come on at 6 o'clock, and Cronauer would say, "Good morning, Vietnam." And we knew we made it through another night. So,
no. Hey, listen, that's what we love is we have a lot of interviews with DJs from Vietnam in there. And a lot of these, you know, you have people say AFVN was crap, it was pablum. And a lot of people say it saved my life and it knew I got into another day. The only reason we're somewhat snarky about Cronauer is, I mean, you've all seen the movie, right? Robin Williams and Adrian Cronauer, as politically as far apart as you can get. And believe me, when Cronauer found out, we wanted to talk to him. Obviously, the Dawnbuster show, you know, I mean, what he did, you know, the film, even though it was different than the way the movie was. But when he found out we were from the People's Republic of Madison, he didn't want to talk to us. He just assumed we were communists, and he didn't want to. But it's true. I mean, Cronauer became, you know, he worked for Dick Cheney. I mean, he sort of went way, and he just.
That's did, UW graduate, Dick Cheney, by the way.
That's right, right, right. Five draft deferments, Dick Cheney. Donald Trump had four, okay? But, you know, I just think, you know, I that music, and to me, these men and women, because we had a lot of donut dollies and Red Cross people that played music for the guys that, you know, they saved our lives, because that was just a way for us, like you said, knowing we made it, we were back, we could live for another day, and the songs that they played, you know, made us feel alive. Yeah. Yes, sir. Oh, sorry.
I was in Vietnam in 67 and 68, and I'm telling you, it was music and booze that got me through.
All right.
No, don't.
Now we're talking.
I also am a graduate of the University of Wisconsin.
Hey! Hey. Woo!
So we're not all commies.
Glad you made it home, brother.
Thanks, man.
Yes, sir.
Getting back to the music and the little bit of Jimi Hendrix you played there.
Yes.
When I was in the Navy, I was on one of the largest warships ever built, an aircraft carrier. For one particular night, I don't know why, but I got up in the middle of the night and I was going aft for midnight rations. I served with a sweetheart of a guy named Dave Miranda. He was a Hendrix fanatic and could play anything Jimmy played.
Man. Wow.
Now, picture an aircraft carrier. It's pitch black outside. It's quiet for a change. Nobody's flying. I'm walking across the hangar deck. There's war machines, I mean, right next to each other. You know, you have to duck under the wings. And I hear the Star-Spangled Banner. It stopped three of us in our tracks, and all three of us had tears running down our face.
Wow.
It was Dave sitting way over in the corner all by himself, playing.
Wow.
I'll never forget that.
Well, every time we do these things, we hear stories that we wish were in the book.
Yeah. Like that one.
And, you know, I know right where we would have put that one. So thank you.
That's not the USS Ranger you were on, was it?
American.
Okay, because I went out. Yeah, I worked for an Army newspaper, and they thought it would be cool for the Army to write a story about about the Navy, so I went out and did a story on the USS Ranger.
That's why I was in the Army, too. I wanted to see how the other half.
You had it better, I think.
Yeah. 3 years in the Army, I'm fine. I spent the rest of the day.
Any other questions about songs? There's plenty of music we didn't play tonight. You know, here's a crazy thing. I mean, one of the worst things we've done about music, because it's so great and we all love it, is that it's become so litigious that it's absolutely ridiculous. I mean, we can't even quote extensive lyrics from the songs, let alone include a CD. And people today still can't get the rights that we got to get out of this place without paying a heck of a lot of money. Neil Young won't let Ohio go. We didn't talk about any of that stuff. So it was just impossible. But on our website, which is the initials of the book, wggootp.com, we've put up a YouTube list of at least 20 of the songs, because it does help to listen to the music while you're reading the book.
Yeah.
It makes a big difference. Yeah. Others, I guess we can stop and go sign books if you guys are done with us. Yeah.
Did the song Galveston ever?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Great song.
I remember listening to that.
Yeah.
Quite
yeah.
Ago. Yeah.
And Wichita Lineman, for a while, Glenn Campbell was just doing Vietnam.
Right. Yeah.
That was another one of those songs, Galveston. I loved that song on the home front. And until we started working on this book, I didn't realize the obvious that it is explicitly a Vietnam song.
Yeah. I was in a small outfit on a Mekong River in 1969, and we had a guy that would put a harmonica around his neck and a guitar in his hand, and in a small EM club could make up a song off the top of his head.
Wow.
I wish I recorded some of that stuff.
It
was great.
Yeah. Hey, you know, this is enough. We could probably get more testimonials. Can we just have all the Vietnam vets in the room just sort of put up, and let's give them a round of applause. Welcome them home. Thanks, guys. I know Bill wants us to talk about these boots are made for walking because he's sort of a Nancy Sinatra impersonator, but that was that was 50 years ago, in fact, too, and it's got some great Vietnam connections, but go ahead.
There's a song from back then that just makes me think of all wars, but it came out of the Vietnam War, I think, and it goes, huh, war.
Oh, yeah.
Edwin Starr.
What's a good war? Is there any history? Do you have any history on that?
Absolutely nothing. Yeah.
Edwin Starr. Motown was, Marvin Gaye was on Motown, and Motown was very resistant to any politics early on. They wanted to sell records to everybody, and they were afraid that politics would cut that short. They had a producer, Norman Whitfield, who recorded War with Edwin Starr. I heard it through a great bunch of other great Motown cuts, and they really had a battle with Berry Gordy, the head of Motown, over being able to release that stuff. Berry Gordy didn't want to do it, but Norman Whitfield, particularly the producer for Edwin Starr, said, yeah, we're going to do this. We're going to do this, and trust us, people will like it. When Marvin Gaye put out What's Going On, about the same time as War, part of the same story at Motown, Berry Gordy said, we're not doing that, man. Berry Gordy heard What's Going On, the album, he said, Marvin, there's no hits on it. Nobody's going to buy it. And Marvin Gaye said, fine, Barry, but I'm not recording another love song for you until you release the album. So Berry Gordy said to Marvin, he said, well, okay, man, I'll release it, Marvin. One of us is going to learn something. And to give him credit, Berry Gordy said, I learned something. So that's how War got to be. And you're in Black Detroit, man. You know, you're in an angry place with black vets coming back to a burned-out city. And so Edwin Starr comes right out.
But, you know, and the interesting thing is we got that a lot, including that night when I was telling you the story that started, where we were putting the ration cards down and somebody mentioned War and we all laughed at him. It was like, come on, where are we? You know, I mean, it was like sometimes the political overtones of songs, it doesn't mean we didn't have protest music. We heard that stuff. Country Joe, you know, guys did Masters of War and, you know, Draft Dodger Rag. We used to laugh at that stuff. But it was like we were in it. We were in the politics, so we didn't need to hear about it, which was kind of an interesting dynamic. So, people liked the song. We heard it, but it didn't mean like it had any special significance for us because we were there.
Just something positive on War. I did it near a theater transfer in 1971 from Vietnam to Germany. And that same year, I went down to Paris. And at the Crazy Horse Saloon in Paris, I got they played War. They had a performance there with six almost clothed women carrying those drill rifles you see with drill teams. And War kind of has a positive image for me.
Obviously for you, right?
Yeah, for me.
Yeah.
And the song that still brings up a lot of emotions for me for odd reasons from that time was Green Eyed Lady. Didn't know any green-eyed ladies.
Interesting.
Just the song that got played and at a point.
Every song about any girl is in the soundtrack somewhere. Fantasy or reality, don't matter.
So we're going to take
one last question
here.
And gets then to be the questioner. Yes, sir.
We're going to take two questions. There we go.
That's J.D. said one.
One.
I just wondered, we talk about all the songs that came from the stateside, but did you guys ever run across what I call folk songs from Vietnam and record them find out about them?
Yeah. At one point along the way, we started researching that. And we did come up with a little bit of information about it. And then we realized a couple of things. Number one is that we weren't competent to do it. You got to speak Vietnamese to do that thing. And we actually have one of our friends, one of my former grad students, Heather Sturr, I wrote a great book called Beyond Combat about women in Vietnam. And some of the material we got from Donut Dollies and Wax and whatnot is from interviews Heather did. And she does speak Vietnamese. And she's working on a book about Saigon during the war years that I think will incorporate some of that. We had to cut it off somewhere.
Did you not mean Vietnam music? Did you mean?
Not Vietnam.
No, you meant folk song. Yeah. No. The songs that were made in Vietnam. There's a woman named Lydia Fish who's at Buffalo State, and she has just Google her and find it. She has done some wonderful things, including one of the guys that we have in the book, Marty Hoyer, who was he was part of the group called the High Priced Help because he was an officer, and they sang folk songs. And they talk extensively about Edward Lansdale, who was the king of counterinsurgency, who was at the embassy in Saigon. And they would have sessions at his house where they would sing parodies of songs like King of the Road. They would make it about Vietnam. Yeah. They would make fun of the Ballad of the Green Berets. So that a lot of that stuff's collected. So if you go out and find Lydia Fish, get to her collection, you'll be able to hear some of it. Lydia had already done it, and frankly, a lot of that sort of was in the early part of the war, and most of the vets we interviewed seemed to trend toward post 65, 66, 67.
But it is a part of the book.
It's a part of the story.
It is a part of the book.
Absolutely. Be good for you to bring up. JD, can we do one more? Or are we done? I thought there was a...
We got one more?
Yeah, the song that gets me every time I hear it is a CCR song called Running Through the Jungle.
Oh,
and
sure.
I got to tell you, I have a Bose sound system in my car. I crank that thing, and I get chills.
Well, great song.
And that's why she can't hear, right? I mean, yeah.
Great song. Interesting story about Run Through the Jungle. So I did an oral history of CCR, and I talked to John Fogerty about a lot of the songs he wrote, and he wrote a lot of them about Vietnam. He said Proud Mary's about Vietnam, which I never thought. He wrote that when he got his discharge. So it was his happy discharge song. He insists the Run Through the Jungle is not about Vietnam. He says Run Through the Jungle is about violence on the streets of America. Don't matter. It's about Vietnam.
Yeah,
He only gets one vote. He's totally, totally outvoted on that. But great song.
I guess we're done. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Yeah.